Hi, I'm here with Jason Dominguez, who is the Santa Barbara City Council member, law professor, and founder of New Civic Forum. Welcome, Jason. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you for having me here.
Oh, thank you so much. I've had the wonderful opportunity to work with Jason and get to know him over the past couple of years as council member, and been very impressed with your work. And I'd love to learn and have our viewers know a little bit more about your background and what you're passionate about.
So my background is in government. I am a lawyer, and I started as a government lawyer. I worked for the County of Los Angeles. And then I moved up to Santa Barbara and worked for the County of Santa Barbara. I took a few years and worked for the United Nations at the International World Court in The Hague in the Netherlands. And then I came back and I switched from doing government work to primarily doing nonprofit work. Some of that work was with the Legal Aid Foundation of Santa Barbara. The other agency I worked with was the California Rural Legal Assistance. And now I run a new nonprofit called New Civic Forum that I founded. And I was elected to city council. I wanted to have something where there wouldn't be any potential conflicts. So we picked a few areas, advanced healthcare directives and youth leadership, where there's no conflicts with government. So it's a great organization, and I really love what I'm doing. We did a needs assessment and determined these were two of the biggest needs in this community.
How interesting. Can you tell us a little bit more about New Civic Forum and the work that you do with that?
So the Advanced Healthcare Directives Program was something when we talked to people in the public health arena, in medical care, they said, and you know, my background as a lawyer, they said, one of the things you can do is advanced healthcare directives. And since we didn't know what it was, and when we talked to people, they didn't know what it was, we realized this really is a need because there's a knowledge gap, there's a knowledge vacuum. And so what an advanced healthcare directive is, it's the legal instrument you can use to choose what your medical directives are once you lose the ability to make those choices for yourself. And you also get to choose who makes those choices for you. So it's both what you want and who helps to make sure that that happens. And then youth leadership, we work with high school students. We teach them mindfulness. We teach them anti-bullying. We teach them prep, emotional readiness. We teach them how to get ready for the job world if they're not going to college. So it's really teaching them the soft social skills that they don't pick up directly through their high school curriculum. Obviously, they learn a lot of that from being with their peers and from the teachers, but this is a more formalized approach to it. We let them do conversations where they practice these skills, and it's a very successful program.
I so love that, and it's so absolutely needed these days. There's a lot of projects within all of what you have just said. We're in a sharing this with a large-scale project management course. So within the many, what types of projects or large-scale initiatives have you worked on? And if you could tell us a little bit about some of the takeaways that you have from some of those experiences that you can share with our viewers.
So some of the projects I worked on when I was at Legal Aid Foundation, a big event was Cajun Chowderfest. So we had we rented a hotel, and in the first year I did it, we used the Bacara, and we've moved to a couple places, but the Bacara was the biggest ballroom, and so we had vendors come in with food, we had vendors come in with wine, we had entertainment, and thousands of visitors, and it was a very successful event, and it took a year of planning. Excuse me, one of the things I learned was how to plan it with using the least amount of resources, because at the beginning, when I became the executive director, I realized the fundraiser in the past had only raised about $20,000 when you netted out our cost, even though it brought in a lot more revenue. By the time you costed out the amount of salaries, for example, within the organization that were devoted to planning it, so I immediately took measures to try to reduce that cost number so that the overall profit from the fundraiser would be higher. And so that was successful. We raised an extra $50,000 by using volunteers instead of paid internal staff. So that was one of the first lessons I learned, and then also about how to streamline it and have planning set up so that the next time you do it, it's easier, the learning curve is less, because that's another thing. You wanna make, even if you're using volunteers, you wanna make their lives easier. Sure. So you have a manual or a booklet so it's easy for people to read and catch up on what the processes are, who you need to speak with, the paperwork, you know, dealing with, I had to deal with government agencies, the ABC.
You had to deal with government agencies.
And it reminded me, you know, even as a government official now, how Byzantine sometimes processes can be. So it has made me try to streamline processes for people who try to do things within the city of Santa Barbara, whether it's developing a business, developing a residence or a building. The Checklist Manifesto is one of my favorite books. I would definitely recommend it to someone. And it's a checklist system you can use both as someone providing services and as someone trying to use services, because then you have a list in front of you of everything you need to get done. And it can be very transparent, very black and white. It helps with communication. People can be on the same page. So that was something that was very instrumental.
Oh, Checklist Manifesto. I love that. I have so many checklists, it's ridiculous, but I have not looked at that particular format. I'll have to check that out. As a council member, what advice would you have for people who are considering putting on either a large-scale, small event or project, community initiative within your district? But in general, when is it advisable to connect with your city government, your council member, when you're putting on a project? Sometimes it might make more sense, other times it may not be necessary. What are your thoughts?
It really is case by case. It depends on the scope. Obviously, the bigger the scope, the more you want to intervene with the city and get their opinions and their rules early on, because it might shape the venue you choose, for example, or whether you're serving alcohol or doing a raffle. Those are things that require government permission, whether you're doing it late at night. So it really depends on how ambitious your plan is. Are you using a parking lot? Coastal zone requires a separate permit. So there's a lot of questions, and that's why I think having a checklist of what you're going to try to do is important. Meeting with your neighbors or anyone who might be impacted by your event is also very important. And finding people who might want to get involved and help early on, particularly professionals who've done events, is also very important.
Excellent. And then if people are interested in speaking with their government officials, council members, mayors, what would you say are positive ways they can go about that? And what are some no-nos that you would advise against?
Again, you know, coming in early is great. the worst situation is when they come in, you know, the week before the event and they plan an event that just is incompatible with the rules. And they ask me to try to break the rules. And it's like, well, I can't do that. So that's the big no-no is make sure you've cleared all the major hurdles way ahead of time. And that's really the big thing is just make sure that it's compatible with where you're trying to do it and with your neighbors.
And so would you say that, you know, you want to reach out to your neighbors as well as reach out to your government officials to just, you know, build camaraderie and build support for this new initiative? It's always challenging to get something started, but and so you generally want to have as many people know about it, but are there some things that just are not that you wouldn't really want to hear about, or are you open, like how accessible are you?
I want to hear about everything, because I think there are things that people just don't realize, uh-huh. and that I can shed some light on from the beginning. You know, most projects are a win for at least one group, and I can help them shape it into a win-win. Mm-hmm. So for example, you may have an event where you're thinking primarily about your normal visitors, customers, supporters, but it may be something that more members of the public would be interested in if it was marketed properly or changed the vision, and you could possibly double the number of people who come.
Awesome.
So since I've, you know, been around different events, I can kind of tell you and anyone who comes to me what typical attendances might be based on the type of event, whether there's music, whether there's entertainment, that type mm-hmm. of thing. And also, again, connect you with other groups who might be able to provide some technical support, you know, party suppliers, party planners. There's so many things, there's so many professionals in Santa Barbara in particular. Any city that's really set up for a lot of tourism has a lot of infrastructure and professionals who can really help, you know, with 10X, right? There's this concept of 10X. having your product, your event 10 times more successful. You can get 10 times the revenue if it's a fundraiser, or 10 times as many people if it's outreach oriented. It's really important to use those professionals and connect you to those folks or give you some tips that might help.
Wow, this is really great to hear from you on all of these subjects. And I've asked these questions in part because I know that you're an accessible council member and that there are many council members, you know, anywhere in this world that are accessible. But I do think that people are often standoffish to reach out to their government officials because it maybe either feels scary or they're not sure about how to go about it. But I'm glad that we're having this conversation because all the things that you just said, I mean, I don't think that most event planners would be like, wow, he's gonna offer me contacts, resources, like so impressive. So thank you for sharing all of that.
Yeah, and I hope no one's scared of government officials. I think it may be more that they're not used to doing it. So the first time you try something out of your normal standard operating procedure, it's different or it's difficult. But, you know, we want events to be successful. Santa Barbara really prides itself on being an open air, accessible city. And the more events we have, the better it is for our city.
Awesome.
You want to make sure they're in the right place at the right time to maximize their value to people.
So if people wanted to set up an appointment with you, how long in advance should they maybe schedule? Because I know you're super busy, just to give people a feel for what kind of time frame they should allocate. Because it, you know, an event, when you're planning something a year, 2 years out, there's a lot of scheduling to be done. And I know that you're working on many different initiatives. You know, City Council is just one portion of your entire day's schedule. Should people allocate a week, several weeks? What would you advise?
And it varies different seasons of the year. Of course. You know, we're really busy in April and May because we're working on our budget. But I would say, you know, a week or two, 2 weeks, you're definitely safe because I can squeeze you in definitely within 2 weeks. If you call me, you know, 3 days ahead of time and my schedule's already impacted, that may be a problem. But somewhere between a half a week to 2 weeks, I should be able to squeeze you in, even if it's just a quick conversation to get the ball rolling and set up a date for a future more in-depth meeting. So again, it just depends. It may be a fortunate week where I have, you know, meeting time that afternoon or in the next couple of days. But generally, I think for most government officials, if you call with a week or two of lead time, it's pretty easy to find a date that's mutually accessible. And it depends on the other person's schedule too. They may say, hey, I'm free, you know, 3 p.m.s every day of the week, which happens to be, you know, a sitting meeting time of ours, then it may take longer to get a time set up. So it really depends on both parties' availability, or if they're out of town, it may take longer to find the right date.
Great. And since you have run for political office and there's a lot of people in this group that are planning campaigns, marketing campaigns, projects, can you talk a little bit about your experience running your own successful political campaign and what people should know about as they're considering their own, whether it's political or otherwise?
I think the first thing is have a clear vision of what your goals are, set out an intention statement, need to be or want to be, because one, you want to make sure you personally and individually have a clear mind frame, but you also have people who are on your team engaged, because I've seen where clearly in their mind, but then there were three or four different visions, and as it turns out, you know, it kind of push people in different directions or people are pulled in different directions. So make sure you have a clear statement of your purpose, vision statement for the event, because then everyone can kind of focus around that. So that's to me, the most important thing. And also try to keep it pretty simple and elegant. If you're looking at three or four pages, you probably haven't, you know, had the time to focus it down to what you really want to achieve. So that would be the very first thing. And I think that's where a lot of people get into trouble is they start early, but they don't have the vision. So they spend a few months or a lot of their time redefining, and they come back with something completely different, which is great as far as I'm concerned. But for them, if they're on a budget or a timeline, it may cause them problems.
And approximately how long does it take to mean, obviously there's the beginning thought process of it, and that there's all of the work and relationship building that you've led up to the point of making a decision to run. But can you talk a little bit about the time frame that is involved with running for office, and what, you know, how you keep going? Because I'm sure in a lot of regards, sometimes things get tough and you have a lot of decisions to make that are challenging, whether you're in office or with your projects. How do you personally kind of keep upbeat and keep going? Because you are very upbeat and you do so much. So how do you do that?
You can't see the panic in my eyes right now. It is important to create a timeline, a rough timeline, knowing that at the end of the day, some of the things may get a little thrown off, but you're ready for it. I did a fundraiser earlier this year where it was a 3-week timeline. So it was actually pretty efficient.
Wow. Very efficient.
The venue fell into our lap, so it kind of forced us to work effectively, which is great, because we probably could have spent, you know, 6 weeks or 3 months on that same project. But basically, it was a restaurant opening where I had mentioned to someone, we're going to do a fundraiser later this year. And he said, hey, I've got this great venue. You should talk to this guy. He's opening this place. And I said, oh, do you know when he's opening? And he said, yeah, I think he's opening it in about 3 weeks.
Well, exactly.
So the idea was to go in before it had the official opening, because one, that would provide him with publicity from all the people I invited. And he could use it as a soft opening where he could test his staff and his facilities and make sure they were able to serve a large group without, you know, having it, you know, getting bad Yelp reviews because it was actually charging, you know, paying customers. So we worked out a deal with him where he would make some revenue off it, get to test his facility, which was an amazing, cool new facility. It helped us because people wanted to see this really neat new facility in kind of a sneak preview mode. And we just got our invitations out right away. We did a quick flyer. And so it forced us to just get it done without having the luxury of overdoing it and overthinking it. And it was a very successful event. So we were very happy with times. Being on a timeline that's a little more accelerated than your comfort zone can be good, because you have to be spare and efficient.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of the overall campaign, you know, for an election like this, it's kind of a year project where I spent the first 9 months fundraising and meeting with people and doing a listening campaign. And then knowing that the last 3 months after the listening and the fundraising, I would do kind of the other side of it, which is explaining then what I wanted to do for people after I've listened to what their needs and their challenges are, what the opportunities are. I was able to create kind of a marketing campaign or a messaging campaign. Well, here's what I've learned, and this is what I'm telling people. And so then the last 3 months is just bringing that message out, figuring out the modalities to get it out, whether it's digital. My preferred method is face-to-face and knocking on doors. So that's very time-consuming, but I find it the most meaningful and endearing to the soul. So that's what I use the most. But we'll also do some mail. We'll be on a TV and radio a little bit too, with interviews, which I also like that format, kind of like what we're doing now, where you can have the face-to-face time, but then more people get to share in seeing that communication.
Beautiful. Well, that's super helpful to get a feel for that time frame and what all is involved. And that's a lot of the stuff that we'll be talking about in this course, the marketing aspect, the media aspect, the time frames, and all of that stuff. So this is super helpful. Is regarding just keeping going when things get challenging. Can you talk a little bit about that?
I think that comes back to your goal setting. So keep your expectations fairly reasonable. And so with our fundraiser, we knew, for example, that it was a short time frame. So we didn't expect what we would have if we did a longer time frame. And so that way, when when things come out a little bit differently, your expectations are still met. So it's just important that you create expectations that are reasonable. If you're doing something for the first time, you know, keep low expectations, you know, talk to other people than in the past. Because I think that's important, is don't become frustrated or negative because things are turning out different. Learn to be ready to ad lib and be flexible as things happen. So that, you know, part of being able to do that is have a little extra time baked into the process and have people in reserve who are willing to come out and help at the last minute if things do change up.
Excellent. Great advice. Anything else you'd like to share? Anything that you have coming up that we should know about and keep a lookout for?
Nothing really. I mean, there's a lot of things. I don't know which one to pick out, but I think really just, you know, talking about the attitude, having the positive attitude. I think the most important people is the most important principle is you're recruiting people and you're enrolling them on a journey and an adventure. And you want to keep it fun. You want to make sure people aren't scared or that it's life and death. You really want to get people enrolled. You want to bring out the best of their personalities, and you want to keep it fun and light. And I think sometimes it's hard to keep that in mind when you are getting stressed or pressured or panicked. And you have to keep reminding yourself that, whether you put, you know, post-its on your computer or you have a chief happiness officer who's part of your team who reminds people and tries to keep the mood light and buoyant. You know, it's like with our advanced healthcare directives, we have some very deep conversations because you're talking about end of life experiences.
And
in our country, we're not good at talking about dying. We're really good at talking about life and happiness, but when it comes to dying, people find it very awkward. And you have to try to make light of the situation and get people to relax, do breathing exercises if you need to, tell some jokes, get people to tell some stories. But you have to remind yourself there's a mental health component, there's a kind of spiritual component to everything, and not just focused on the goals or the timeline, but also how are people's experiences. Someone said, I'm forgetting who it was, you probably know, it's people remember how you made them feel more than, you know, what you accomplished. You remember who it was, that Maya Angelou maybe?
Maybe. That's a good quote.
That's so important that you're curating the experience for people who are part of your team at the same time. Do a check-in at your meetings. How's everyone doing today? And if, you know, someone's having a bad day, say, hey, after our project today, why don't we go, you know, have a glass of tea or something, or, you know, show support for people on your team who may be having a bad day if possible.
All amazing advice. Thank you so much for joining us, Jason. I wish you the best of luck in all your upcoming endeavors. You're doing amazing things, so keep it up. And thank you for sharing all of these insights with our class.
You bet. Thank you. And keep doing your great work. I appreciate it for our community and now the greater community who will get these great tips and techniques and be able to bring great events to their communities.
Appreciate it. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care.